Ciao to everybody, I'm Francesco Sanapo from Italy. I'm the Italian Barista Champion and I work in a coffee business for 15 years now, 16. If I will be the champion or not, my mission is always the same, to increase the coffee quality in all worlds. This is it. And which animal? Maybe it's easy, lion, because it's the king. You must have heard it.
So while the judges introduce themselves to the next competitor, I'd like to introduce him to you. The World Barista Championships finalist, number 3, the Barista Champion of Italy, Francesco Sanapo! So, Francesco, when you're ready, if you raise your arm to start your clock,
yep.
Huge congratulations on making the finals. The floor is yours.
Go. Hi, judges. During the past few years, I've been concentrating on studying the extraction of the espresso. After every single day at the bar, every travel, every person I meet, I realize that there is always something new to discover and to learn. For this reason, I believe my researches will never end, because I love my job and always want to serve the best coffees to my customers. This is exactly what I'd like to do today, but together with you, I want to concentrate on what happens to the espresso after the barista say enjoy, and to analyze with you the life of an espresso. At the first, I would like to introduce to you my coffee through its dry aroma. Please, shake the cup in front of you, open it, smell it, enjoy the dry aroma. Meanwhile, I'll proceed with the first preparation, which is my cappuccino.
Okay.
So, Francesco, this is his second time competing.
Judges, while I'm doing this, please copy from the card in front of you the notes of my espresso and my cappuccino.
It's his second time of competing. First time was in Bogota in 2011, and Francesco himself says he didn't feel that he got to show his best side. Making finals now is obviously a big move on from that, and he's really happy about it, really happy.
Extraordinary. You know, Francesco mentioned that he's worked in coffee for 15 years in the teaser before his... But actually, he's been surrounded by coffee his entire life. His father is a barista.
Yep. Now they own their own bar, don't they? Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. And so he's from the... he's born in the Puglia region of Italy, which is the heel of the boot. So that's southern Italy, which is known for its intense coffees. He now lives in the north of Italy, in Florence, which is known for much sweeter coffee. So I wonder which direction he's going in today.
I mean, he's travelled a lot. He's tasted an awful lot of espresso, an awful lot of coffee, and he has a great appreciation for the whole specialty movement. And he also has a passion to kind
for
of transfer
me,
that into Italy.
It's very important. When you pick up a cup of espresso, voluntarily or not, is one of the first sensations that involve us. So, swirl the cup, smell the wet aroma, but please don't drink it because I need it for my cappuccino.
Good bit of humor in there, that's always good.
Yep.
The coffee that I'm presenting to you is an Ethiopian coffee, called Nekise and grown in the Sidama region between 1700 and 2000 meters of altitude. It's a mix of Ethiopian heirloom variety and it's a natural coffee. For you. In my cappuccino, this coffee will emerge thanks to the great sweetness, which will manifest through notes of white chocolate, milk chocolate, and toffee. Judges, take the first 2 sips now, and I tell you very shortly when to take the 3rd and 4th sip. This is just to have a full experience of my cappuccino. For you.
Really going for it with the latte art.
Right, absolutely.
I'll be right back.
Okay, so he's going to return. He's going to make another couple of cappuccinos for the judges. He's mentioned the origin of his coffee, which is southeastern Ethiopia, right around Yirgacheffe, which is a famous coffee town in southern Ethiopia. Of course, Ethiopia is the homeland of coffee. It's coffee is indigenous to Ethiopia. It's been grown in that part of Ethiopia for thousands of years, intentionally by people who consume it. So he's going back to the origin of coffee itself for his coffee choice. And of course, Italy has its own historical relationship with Ethiopia as well. So we don't know if that figured into it or if he's just going by flavor alone.
I mean, we talked about the diversity of El Salvador in an earlier presentation. Here's a country that has so many cultivars, so many differences in cooking processing methods, in cooking methods. And I mean, the Kizu region's become quite famous for its natural coffees. I know that if Francesco serves it, it's just going to be delicious.
Yes, and it's funny, he's mentioned a little
judges,
bit about aromatics.
Please take the third and fourth sip now, and you judge on smell and enjoy the wet aroma without drinking. I have known this coffee for 5 years now, and I've been following year after year its constant improvements. The cherries are selectively picked when they are ripe. They are drying on African bed on a single layer and move every 2 hours. They are removed from the bed when the moisture content reaches 12%. This precise method allows a homogeneous drying of the cherries and also a good sugar influence on my coffee. Take the first 2 sips now, and I'll tell you shortly when to take the third and fourth sip.
Okay, so he's actually instructing the judges down to the order and number of their sips. That's an incredible amount of control. He's clearly after something here.
Yes. For you, madam.
That's it for the cappuccinos!
Okay, so he's talked about the process that these coffee cherries go through. That's the important part of a natural coffee like this. Being dried inside the fruit, it's always at great risk of spoiling. And so he's talked about the cherries having to be turned on African beds. African beds are wooden, usually wooden or wire screens that the coffees are dried on so that the air can circulate underneath them.
And that's been a big point people have pointed out in all
of
the coffees.
As I said in the introduction, now I would like to focus on the life of the espresso, to simulate what happens in the coffee bar after serving the espresso. I realize it never happened in just one sip, but more than one. The customers start to drink an espresso, and then talk with a friend or read a newspaper. Each person take his time to drink an espresso. I found out this time is generally around 60 seconds. Now I want you to try my espresso over this time. Judges, you can take the third and fourth sip, and I'll be right back with my espresso.
Okay, so explaining to us why you want them to drink over the different times, that this coffee's going to change and develop and be different. And again, this is a very common theme that we've seen all the way through these competitions, strict directions of when to do things. And this is from the new rule a couple of years ago where you can instruct the judges exactly what to do.
Yep. And he's making oblique reference to the espresso culture of Italy. Of course, Francesco's from Italy, and Italy is the inventor of the espresso brewing technique and also the kind of culture around espresso drinking that infuses much of this competition. The use of cappuccinos, the use of espresso, these are Italian references. And he hasn't overtly stated this yet, but he's sort of making subtle sort of references to this culture and how well he knows it.
For sure. I mean, he's been around it his whole life. He had the conversation with him. He drank cappuccinos as a baby. This is a common thing as a young boy.
And he clearly wants to be an ambassador of that. And, you know, I talked to him a little bit before his routine today, and he's just really passionate about representing Italy well and showing how much the technique sort of coffee runs through his veins. I think that's cool.
Judges, in 3 sips, now I want to analyze the evolution of the taste of the espresso along his life. After evaluating the crema, I ask you to stir the espresso with a spoon and then start with the first sip. After that, please put the cup down again. Enjoy.
Okay, he's making reference to the crema, that foam that is on top of every great espresso.
He's just pressed a timer, which has started. from the first sip.
What emerged in this sip is the smoothness of the espresso, its elegance and the great balance. Regarding the taste, you can feel a pleasant acidity, which you recall a red fruit acidity, such as raspberries. Now, please swirl gently the cup and take the second sip. After that, please put the cup down again. Honestly, this is my favorite phase, like an explosion of the taste due to an intensification of the acidity, which in this phase recall peach pulp notes and the typical sweetness of cane sugar. In the third and last sip, you will keep perceiving the acidity, but the main characteristic is the juicy body and notes of ripe fruit, dry plums, and chocolate. That brings a subtle bitterness in my coffee. Please swirl and take the last sip. I hope you enjoy my 60 seconds.
60 seconds.
Ciao, ciao, Mr. Espresso!
Beautiful instructions on how to explore his the layers of his espresso flavor. I noticed that his cups are quite wide. They're almost saucer-like. That's unusual shape for espresso.
For sure. I think, again, he's trying to cool this temperature down, and it's all about the temperature being cool. And I said earlier, this is a theme, and it's happening again. The interesting thing with the minute thing is, as I was talking to Francesco, he's saying that basically he sees this as when he goes to a coffee bar, it takes him a minute to drink his espresso. That's very Italian, isn't it?
Right.
You know, they just you have a minute out of your life, and then on you go, and that's what he was trying to represent with the timer.
Ah, I see. And he's mentioned red fruit acidity. I can't help but notice that carafe, that glass carafe that we see at the front, is also red and probably is some sort of fruit infusion.
I like this coffee because it's selectively picked, carefully processed. So the sensations are very clear, clean and refined throughout the cooling down of the temperature. And this is what I would like to highlight in my signature drink, where you will get three shots with three different temperatures and different taste profile to continue the experience of the lifetime of an espresso. Regarding the temperature, as you just realized, the espresso cooled down over 60 seconds. To simulate that, I will use three different temperatures on the glasses and also control the temperature of my ingredient. So, the first glass will be the warmest, and then the second and third less and less warm. Regarding the taste, in the first shot, I will reinforce the fine acidity of red fruit, which is represented here by an infusion of raspberries in water. You perceive it in the first sip of my espresso. In the second shot, we have a reduction of peach pulp and cane sugar, which was represented in my espresso by same notes. Okay. In the third shot, we'll have a combination of bitterness and sweetness, identified here by ripe fruit, dried plums, and chocolate. And after that, I will go to make a magnificent, fantastic espresso. I'll be right back.
Okay. So we were right. He's tied in with a raspberry infusion to get to this red fruit acidity. I think he said some sort of stone fruit. Was it nectarine in the center?
Didn't catch that.
Yeah. It's really a creative idea to try to mimic the experience of drinking the previous course, which was nothing but an espresso, with this signature beverage that accentuates these different time phases of the life of the espresso.
What do you think to this music playing such a big part in performances now? Because this is obviously quite... he knew at this time he's going to be pulling his espressos for the sink, drinking to put the music in to get the code going. I mean, I think it builds atmosphere, but could it be distracting?
Yeah, that's a good question. There's clapping going on, a lot of intensity. I hope the judges can focus. I'm seeing the Brewers Cup earlier in this week, and I noticed a lot of variation between intense music and very relaxing music. Obviously, he's trying to get some energy going here. Hopefully, that translates into high scores from the judges.
I love competition music, but sometimes I just wonder whether it's a little stage and can be that distracting part. I think it should be good, it should be uplifting, it should make the judges feel good and comfortable. I don't know whether it should create that tense atmosphere.
Right. There is a lot of intensity in the room at the moment as he's preparing these steel pitchers of espresso.
Now, I will divide espresso into three parts in order to prepare the three shots for completing my drink. Please mix every single shot with a spoon and start drinking from the one closest to you. The first shot is all about acidity from high altitude coffee. Enjoy.
High altitude coffee is known to have a higher acidity than other kinds of coffees, and he's making reference to that, making sure the judges appreciate the acidity, which of course can be a delicate balance. Great acidity is delicious in coffee.
Show how clean sweetness is, a result of careful dry process.
Of course, on the score sheet as well, that he is scored on his coffee knowledge and how much he knows about the coffee. That's just another tick in a box and another point on the sheet, which the single little points can be just so important.
Is all about what I like in my coffee. Juicy, sweet, bitterness, easy. Great espresso.
Okay, so he's demonstrating his passion for the coffee in the second phase.
It took me 15 minutes.
Got 20 seconds left.
What happens during those 60 seconds, the life of an espresso. I do believe it's a very important part of the coffee culture because it's the moment lived by our customer. Time.
14:53. There's a flag waving at the one of the skyboxes. A lot of enthusiasm for Francesco's routine.
A lot of Italians here because they're selling machines and all that.
Yeah.
Oh.
Every time.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I loved the expansion of your theme at the end of that idea where you took one coffee moment and explored it, one moment over 15 minutes. Where did that idea come from, that time idea?
Do you want to know the true story?
I do. I want to know the true story.
Everybody want to know the true story? I was behind the coffee bar, and I served my espresso to two girls. I served the espresso, and then they start to talk about shopping, shoes. I was really upset, because I say, come on, drink my espresso, start to make the temperature cool down. After that, I just turn my face, I look on the table, and one guy read a newspaper, and take a sip, we'll relax, you know. And I just realized that everybody drink the espresso in its time, it's a break, it's just to enjoy. After this, I just, I have to compete. It's a good idea. Easy. After that, the day after, I just came to the coffee bar with a timer, and I check the timing of everybody. Okay, every people drink espresso. When I put the espresso on the bar, I just push the button and I check that really everybody. I never see the person drink an espresso in boom one shot.
Really,
it is start after that. I get in love with this coffee.
Do you think that's a very Italian thing then? That you're just taking your time to enjoy the espresso, or?
I think in several countries. The people drink the espresso in this time, not only in Italy. Maybe in UK, there is a people, they sit and drink an espresso. You know, it's the same. In Italy, they stay on the bar and drink an espresso, but the espresso is the same around the world.
I think one thing I'm very envious of being in the UK is that ingrained espresso culture that is in Italy. You know, that people enjoy espresso, and I don't know what the percentages are in Italy, but in the UK it's like 2-3% of people drink espresso. Do you find do you like serving espressos, or you like serving milk drinks, or you really don't care?
I think if I understand your question is that when we start to drink an espresso in Italy, it was really several years ago. And now when I travel around for my work and I visit several coffee bars, I just recognize that
the espresso starts to go up. Every day more people drink an espresso. It is for all 53 barista from this beautiful event. Because every champion, I told to you yesterday, every champion, we are champion all life.
Right.
For all the life. We have to talk to increase the coffee quality in every part of the world.
And I think you've taken that ambassador thing on really very well. I mean, just let the audience know, like, how much you said about traveling. I mean, how much traveling have you done in the last 2 years? It must be immense. It's, yeah, Costa Rica, El Salvador.
I have two things about that, okay, that I want to say. One is when I am behind the bar, I have to serve the espresso and to show to the customer how good it is. To teach them in a simple way. We don't need scientific. Right. We don't need nothing that. The customer, they don't need to know about the process, about roasting profile. But the barista, yes, is so important. And for that, I spent two years to travel around every country, origin country, but also he is one of my guy that inspired me.
Yeah. Very good. He inspired me too.
Yeah, I'm that kind of guy. Yeah. So I think the one thing that we've talked a lot about is engaging customers, how we engage them, how we bring them in to our coffee thing. I want to hear your thoughts on how we do that. So what way do we engage the customer so they get as inspired about it as we do? What would be your tip? What was your thing?
Do you want to know I made a pour over in Italy.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
Do you want to know how the people start to drink a coffee drip in Italy?
Tell me.
I say, hey, ciao. How are you? Okay. Today I have a special infusion of coffee. I can't call it filter coffee.
Sure.
Because the people start to think, oh, filter coffee.
Right, right, right.
Hot water, you know?
Right.
But I know it's not true, but I have to use the communication to involve the people to taste the espresso in my way.
Right, right, right.
Well, that's exactly it. When people taste good coffee, they tend to like it because people like good things, but it's getting them to taste it is the big barrier.
Tell me about that. We noticed we were talking about during your routine those espresso cups, how they're quite wide in comparison with some of the other ones. Your espresso cup.
See?
Yes. No. We could see them already, but they were just quite wide.
I made this cup with a German factory.
Uh huh.
Yeah. And this is what I like to call an ergonomy sip.
Uh huh.
Because I just taste several cups because it is so important.
Absolutely.
It's simple things, but you have to be focused on that.
Right.
And this is what I like to call ergonomy sip. Because when you start to drink an espresso, the crema was in your first part of the lips, and you feel the smoothness.
Sure.
But the liquid start to go down very, very fast,
uh-huh.
More fast than crema. And this is because I need the first sip to be balanced and also to bring more sweetness on my on the taste.
Beautiful. Yeah. And this, I don't know if you can see this at home, but these, this is actually angled, the interior of this is actually angled in such a way to deliver this this crema in the way that he wanted, this ergonomic way.
Is one for you and one for you.
Ah, okay. Grazie.
It's my personal gift.
Grazie.
So, I know that you kind of, you kind of want to baristas to act in a certain way and to get that message out there. Have you got something that you would like to tell potential baristas who are just starting up in coffee, how they can kind of improve and get better? You know, a message to all the baristas watching who are going, there's an Italian guy there who's doing really well in barista competition. What's your message to them to do to get where you are?
I open the door, okay, for all young barista, because in this last 3 years, I also did a lot coffee training, a lot barista training, and I meet a lot young barista, the new generation of Italian coffee people. And so for me to be in the final is one of the first beautiful things is that I show to every young barista that something is possible. If you really want, if you work hard for that, everything is possible.
That's an incredible message.
This is my message, and study the coffee, because it's so important.
Absolutely. Oh, wonderful, wonderful sentiment. That's inspiring to me as a barista myself, I think, and that really is a wonderful message that probably infuses this entire competition, which is to aspire to excellence.
We talked a lot about, like, you know, how you want to change and develop Italian coffee culture, but there's so many good things in Italian coffee culture. Tell us one thing that like the rest of the specialty community should be taking out of Italy. Like, there's lots of things I've took from places like Viva Espresso in El Salvador. Tell me something that is really good about Italian coffee that you think is super exciting that the rest of the world should do.
What I like from Italian coffee?
Yes.
We never do the line. Never.
No line.
No line. Because espresso is a simple, it's 30 seconds.
Sure.
We have to come to the bar to order an espresso and to take. I don't like the line, just this. In the coffee bar, no. Maybe in the hospital, the airport, right. And several part right. of our life, it's good to do the line. But in the coffee bar, no. Right. Go on the bar.
Do you think that's a workflow thing, that you're just so used to making espresso after espresso in Italy that you can control so that line doesn't happen? Do you think...
So about the coffee quality that you serve?
Yeah, mm-hmm. but do you think yeah. that there isn't a line because you're just so used to serving espresso? Yeah. And for some shops, they don't have the workflow, right?
Yeah, you don't have the contact with the client. But in my experience, no, because I always search the contact. It's a one smiley and enjoy your coffee. I never served espresso without to say something, okay? Mm-hmm. Of course, there is some coffee bar where you go and you don't have any contact with the barista, but it's not all.
Right.
Not all.
Yeah. Let's talk about this coffee for a second from Nikise in southern Ethiopia. Yeah. That's obviously an unusual coffee choice in Italy. Yeah, yeah. Tell me about your discovery of this coffee and your exploration of it.
When I start to... Oh, thank you. When I start to taste the coffee for my competition, I start to taste like six, seven different coffee. And Nekise was one of the first that... where I recognize the balance, because this is what I try to search every time in my espresso. And after that, when I start to create my performance, mm-hmm. is one of the best coffee that give me the opportunity to talk how the people drink an espresso and how the temperature goes down every second, you know?
I see. So is it
how the espresso change.
Right. It's a dynamic coffee. It has to yeah. change a lot from the first moment yeah. to the last. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Have you served it at your bar yet, ever?
So I serve in Italy uh-huh. in three different coffee bar, because before to decide my performance, I start to listen the ordinary people, you know?
Right.
I start to listen. I don't say to them, please take three sips.
Right.
No, I just say, the coffee is good?
Mm-hmm.
Wow, it's wonderful. Because I just say to the customer that, please, don't put the sugar in my coffee. And after, tell me, what do you think?
Right.
And it was amazing experience, because every people say, wow, this coffee, they don't need the sugar, because the good coffee never
right.
has the sugar in it.
Right, it's sweet by itself. Beautiful. Well, it sounded sweet. It sounded delicious. I hope to get a little taste of the coffee a little bit later.
Yes. Yeah, we're gonna track you down for some of that coffee so we can all try it. So I think all that's left to do is one last big round of applause for the World Barista Championship finalist, number 3 Barista Champion of Italy, Francesco Sanapo!